Well, very well sung. That sounded terrific. Can I just give a final little urge for the food for thought dinner? Don't neglect to book your tickets. Have a last go at inviting some friends. It's going to be a great, great night on Thursday. Now, I really enjoy getting to the end of a series like Ephesians. There's sort of a sense of finishing something. And it's been great to be working through Ephesians together. And this morning, it is chapter 6, the last section of chapter 6. And you'll find it on page 1177 in the Church Bibles. It's quite a short passage. We're reading from verse 10. And perhaps some familiar words to many of you. So it's Ephesians chapter 6, picking up in verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armour of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armour of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled round your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I'm an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Tychicus, the dear brother and faithful servant in the Lord, will tell you everything so that you may know how I am and what I'm doing. I'm sending him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage you. Peace to the brothers and sisters and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Well, do keep your Bible open there. And let me pray before we get started. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this part of your word that we've enjoyed so richly these past weeks. And Father, we pray that once again this morning you would warm our hearts by your Spirit, that the sword of your word would cut deep, that we might come away strengthened and encouraged. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 9 days after the attack on the Twin Towers on September 11, 2001, President George W. Bush declared a war on terror. Remember his words? 8 years later, in his inaugural address in January 2009, Barack Obama also said, "Our nation is at war against a far-reaching network of violence and hatred." It is, of course, a war that's still going on, city by city, attack by attack. A war that, in a sense, I'm not sure that we're winning. A war that we're fighting at great cost against an enemy that's almost undefined. A network of violence and hatred, and a network that the media and the police and our government hesitate to even call by name because of what they see as a great threat to our social cohesion. How do you win a war like that? Because it seems you can't just bomb violence and hatred into submission. If you're going to win, you want to somehow replace violence and hatred with something better, like perhaps gentleness and love. We haven't really defeated it at all. And yet all we can seem to send against it is another wave of jet fighters and yet more violence. And in the end, it's really just profoundly disturbing. Now, that is bad enough. But Paul reminds us, did you notice in this final section of Ephesians, that there is another war on a deeper, unseen level. That's even more disturbing, or perhaps should be. It's the war behind the scenes that underlies, in a sense, every war that's ever been, every word and act of hatred and violence, every episode of lust or greed or murder, every thought that has been anti-good and anti-God. It is a spiritual war. You can pretend it's not happening, you can block your ears and you can cover your eyes, but in the end it is very real, and you and I are caught up in it whether we like it or not. And no matter how comfortable you might want to make your bunker, the reality is we're living in a war zone. If you ask the question, is the world basically a good place full of good people doing good things with the occasional glitch, or is it the other way around? What's your answer? I reckon, you know, if you asked the question maybe 20 years ago, you might have got answer number one. I mean, there are plenty of people who might still say the same, the optimistic view of human nature. We're all basically good except when circumstances push us otherwise. But I reckon, you know, there is a growing tinge of doubt about that. If you're a secular person here this morning and you're prepared to stretch your categories just a little bit, there seems arguably, I would say, so often to be an evil undertone, a kind of a cultural death wish. Maybe it's in the name of freedom of choice, which is actually, when they say that, they mean a freedom to do all kinds of soul-destroying and culture-destroying wrongs without any kind of limit. I want you to notice there's been a thread running right through Paul's letter. You'll see where we're heading on the outline or on the screen behind me, because Paul says, and he said all the way through Ephesians, we are living in a deeply divided world caught up in a spiritual battle, with one who Paul calls back in Ephesians 2, verse 1 and 2, if you just flip back there to chapter 2, calls the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit world. Now, it's interesting. Jesus uses exactly the same term and calls this ruler of the kingdom of the air Satan, which means the adversary. Now, you might not actually believe that there is any such thing as evil, that there is a source of it, that there is a ruler of it, that there's some kind of active agency of evil in our world. And yet so often, you must admit, in all the wrongs that are done in any place and any time, it seems there is a common dark thread that's recognisable as to its sense of origin. Ephesians 2, here's Paul's picture. As for you, all of us, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. That is our world, says Paul. A world with an opponent at work who paints bad as good and good as bad. And Satan is the prince of this world. Paul calls him the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit world, the motivating force behind every act of evil. Flip the page, chapter 4, verse 17. We're just following this thread through the letter, because the fact is, you see, the devil has got a lot of willing conscripts. And again, it's a picture of what the world actually looks like if you take the blinkers off. What people look like, what by our original nature you and I look like. Again, it's a verse we've seen before. It is a dark world, says Paul, darkened in understanding. It's a world that prefers darkness to light. It's a world where when you turn on the lights, the cockroaches scuttle for cover. Here it is, Ephesians 4, verse 17. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you, now that you've become Christian, he's saying, must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding, and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to a sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Now, we looked at that more closely a couple of weeks ago. You can go back and listen to that talk if you want. But that's Paul's description of the human condition in our world. It's interesting, there is a debate going on at the moment, a little bit in the background, but it's one of many debates, debating euthanasia, whether doctors should be licensed and ultimately required in countries like Canada, required to kill terminally ill patients. Andrew Denton is leading a campaign, and the interesting thing about his campaign is this, that he is saying the church, Christians, should be excluded from the debate because the opinion of Christians just shouldn't be taken into account because of our bias. In other words, he says, don't even listen to the life side, just listen to the death side. Now, that's our world. There was a new license being handed out in the UK for a television operator a couple of years ago. The choice was between a Christian channel and a pornography channel. Which do you think won the rights to operate? See, don't listen to the light, listen to the dark. Paul says that's the inclination of our world. Don't be surprised. Constant lusting, never satisfied. Hungry for any kind of impurity they can find. Tony Abbott used to say there's a death cult doing battle across Syria and Iraq. Paul says, look a little bit closer to home. It's in the air we breathe. And the ruler of the air, the dark master, is always looking for a foothold, always looking for a way in. Like chapter 4, verse 26, just something that Paul says in passing, chapter 4, verse 26, see his advice there, don't let the sun go down while you're still angry, and don't give the devil a foothold. Even in how you handle your anger, there's an opponent looking for chinks, opportunities to turn that anger into division and something worse. Verse 15 in chapter 5. Paul says, be very careful in how you live, not as unwise but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. That's the sort of world it is. It is a dark world. That's the sort of days we live in. There is a battle going on, whether we like it or not. And yet the good news is, in the midst of it all, God has got a grand plan. And the grand plan is devastatingly simple. That into the kingdom of the prince of this world comes Jesus the Christ, who calls together a people, a kingdom of his own, out of the darkness and into the light. And look, again, a recap. This is the end of the Bible teaching part of the series, in a sense. So a good opportunity to recap. Back to chapter 1, verse 9 and 10. Back you go. So we first saw the plan spelled out in chapter 1, verses 9 to 10, where Paul says, and he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and earth under one head, even Christ. And you see in his death and his resurrection, chapter 1, verse 20, Christ has been raised and seated at the right hand of God in the heavenly realms to rule over all the forces of darkness. Far above, verse 21, all rule and authority and power and dominion and every title that can be given, putting all things under his feet for and on behalf of his people, the church. That's us. And so when we looked at chapter 3, verse 10, there was that great reminder that through his church, God is making a huge advertisement to the spiritual powers that the forces of evil are undone, that the forces of division and dissension and spite and bitterness are overcome by this great coming together of all kinds of people, of Jews and Gentiles across all kinds of ethnic boundaries, coming together in love. Chapter 3, verse 10, look at his words. His intent was that now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms according to his eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ. Now you see, there again is that incredible thought that through us and the way we love one another across all kinds of barriers, God is actually demonstrating something to the spiritual world, to Satan and his mates, that evil will not prevail. Through us, the way we love, and through the way we forgive, and even through the way we manage our anger and don't give the devil a foothold, in our integrity, our honesty, our sexual purity, through the way we put off old ways and put on new ways, there is a cosmic announcement going out and a picture of what the age to come is going to look like. Through the church, God's wisdom is being broadcast to places and entities that we can't even begin to imagine. So, who do you think you are? It's been our question right through this series. The fact is, you're a key player in God's grand solution. You are a soldier in that cosmic battle. So Paul says you better get your armour on. I mean, that's what it boils down to. And that's how Paul is going to bring the letter to a close. So back to chapter 6, our reading this morning, and take heart, verse 10. Finally, says Paul, and it's more literally for the remainder, not just finally in the letter, but for whatever time that's left. Keep going. If you think things are tough, you're right, we're in a war zone. If you think there's lots of darkness around, then yes, you're seeing things as they actually are. But for the time that's left, he says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Don't think it's up to you. It's not. Call in the big guns and put on, he says, the full armour of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Because as we've seen, there is more to our struggle than meets the eye. Paul says it is not just a struggle against flesh and blood, verse 12, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, which isn't, of course, usually our perspective at all. If you're a modernist, and yet again I think maybe it is the easiest spiritual reality to see evidence of, in the sense that there is so much unnecessary evil around, isn't there? It just doesn't make any kind of sense, so much evil just for the sake of evil. So what do you do? I mean, given that he said we're in this dark place and we're up against the forces of the devil, it's got the makings of the ultimate horror movie in a way, hasn't it? And yet, when you read what Paul's saying, there is a confidence and no fear at all. They are evil days, but you'll be amazed at how little you need to worry about it. Because we Christians, he says, have got all the armour we need. Just make sure you put it on. Which brings us then, you see, to Paul's famous imagery of a Roman soldier in armour that starts in verse 13. He says, therefore, put on the full armour of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything, to stand. When the smoke clears, to be still standing. See, the real question is, when Satan does his worst to tempt you, when the dark days of trial come for you, are you going to be left standing or not? Paul says you can be. You will be. Just keep your armour on. It is tragic, isn't it, when you see Christians fall? It's usually subtle at first, different life goals maybe. Somehow the materialism just sets in. And before you know it, it's the greed that becomes idolatry. It's what you worship. Or there is a niggling anger that you just won't let go, and it gives the devil a foothold and becomes bitterness. And then you're gone. Paul says the goal is to stand firm and in the end to be left standing. And here is the armour that will guarantee we do that. Read from verse 14. Stand firm, then, he says, with the belt of truth buckled round your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Now, if you were a Sunday school kid in years gone by, I reckon just about every Sunday school class in the 60s and 70s did the thing with the tinfoil armour. And, you know, you dress yourself up with a cardboard shield and a tinfoil helmet. But without getting you to do all that this morning, in case you did miss out in your childhood, can I make the point that even though that's good fun, there is nothing childish about this stuff. And yet at the same time, it is not particularly advanced level either. Because when you look at it, the armour that Paul is talking about is the armour of absolutely basic, stock standard, entry level, no frills Christian faith. And it's important to see that. Because, you know, it seems to me there's so much superstition and fear going around when it comes to the devil, even among Christians, maybe especially among Christians, that we need to think about it clearly. And in a sense, the greatest goal of the enemy is to draw our confidence away from the basics of trusting the Lord Jesus and being confident in the gospel. You know, I don't know if you know this, you probably do, but apparently the reason we say bless you when someone sneezes is that back in the Middle Ages sometime they figured out that when you sneezed out some demons. And if someone doesn't say bless you, then the demons would get right on back in. Chinese restaurants, you'll often notice two stone lions guarding the front door. They're there, apparently, to keep away the demons. Throw salt over your shoulder. Apparently that keeps away evil spirits as well. People will try anything except the obvious. Some churches, maybe, they want to slay you in the spirit, make you fall over backwards to drive out the devil. They'll say that if you're sick or you're struggling, it's a demon. They'll say special prayers, said special ways, special techniques in special books. And look, if you're at all confused by any of that kind of stuff, or if your kids are hearing it, can I recommend you talk to our pastor, Kim Jager, about it? Because he has had a lifetime of experience in that sort of world. And he can tell you it doesn't work, because the reality, you see, is far more simple. Because in the end, Paul's saying this. He's saying, yes, it is a dark world. Yes, Satan is at work to undermine God's church. But you've been given the armour you need already. And it's the basic stuff. It's the salvation that came to you in the gospel. Just have a look at the words in bold on the screen. It's the Christian basics. It's truth. The truth of the message about Jesus. It is the righteousness that comes through faith in Jesus. That's our shield. It is the gospel message. It's our salvation that comes from that same faith in Jesus. It's the Spirit at work through the Word of God. It's our prayers about all kinds of stuff. It is the basic, mundane, day by day, week by week walk of the Christian life of trusting Jesus. That's our armour plating. Because in the end, you say, it's not your battle, but God's battle. It's been fought and won by Jesus. It's not your armour, it's his. And it's just the basic stuff of the Christian faith, keeping it on. Are you doing that? Now, it's often been noted, the only offensive weapon that we've got is that word of the gospel. You notice that? The sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And in a sense, that's Paul's final thought for the letter. Paul says, pray for me, and keep praying especially that I will battle on. Pray for me, notice his words, that whenever I open my mouth, that'll be what comes out. the message of the gospel. Hear his words, verse 19. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the words of the gospel. Because you see, that and that alone is the way the kingdom of darkness is pushed back. That and that alone is the way people are brought into the family of God and reconciled to one another through the Lord Jesus. So pray, he says, for gospel opportunities. Opportunities yourself to say a timely word about Jesus and the hope that you have in him. Day by day, knowing that that is the key part of the spiritual battle. Pray for this coming Thursday night, that as Brad speaks about his faith at our Food for Thought dinner, there would be people who are actually ready to hear that and to change their minds about Jesus, step out of the darkness into the light. Pray for boldness to make that last-minute invitation to your friend. Look, if you've got the kind of friends who haven't even given Jesus a passing thought, it'll be a fantastic night to bring them along to, because it just won't make any sense to them at all that a big, tough, footy guy finds his hope in trusting Jesus and not himself. It'll make them think. There is a war zone out there. And who do you think you are? Well, again, you're a soldier in that battle. Paul says, don't fear, put your armour on and stand firm. And let's together keep at the challenge of being light to a dark world, hope in the hopelessness, at peace with God and at peace with one another, while we stand firm against every challenge. I reckon it's been a great journey through Ephesians these past few weeks. Thanks for tagging along with it. Kim's going to share some practical reflections next week, just as a final wrap-up. But it's good, in a sense, to finish ploughing our way through the text with Paul's final blessing in verse 23, because it is exactly for people like us. It's a prayer for peace and love in the middle of the battle and the darkness and the hate. So let's reflect on his words. Peace, he says, to the brothers and sisters, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Gary's going to lead us in prayer, and then we're going to share in the Lord's Supper.
Would you join me? Heavenly Father, thank you that your word leaves us in no doubt at all that the physical battles we face in life are not the only ones, nor are they the greatest. The greatest battle we face is one against an enemy who would, if he could, rob us of peace and of hope. One who would have us believe that our hope in you has no foundation and that we are answerable to no one but ourselves. That life is to be lived as we see fit. That there is no evil. Father, we thank you that because of your word, we are not ignorant to the truth. That you are God and you are righteous, and that whilst you expect us to be like you in character and in righteousness, we are not God. There is an adversary in this world and he's after us. Help us to be aware that the battle we are in and the enemy we face is real, but to be aware also that the battle is won, the enemy is defeated by Jesus. Help us to put on every piece of this armour that you have provided for us. And when the enemy attacks, to stand and to stand firm, to claim the victory that's been won for us at the cross of Calvary, where Jesus poured out his blood for us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Please bless and encourage us now as we remember the blood that was shed and the body that was broken for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.